such as me, such as Ian from WSPA, such as Ingrid, you know, share their experiences, and for us in India to derive lessons from it to develop the movement. So that's the spirit of this message. And so this is approximately a 25-minute message from India. Let's listen to it.
Meaning that they're Coca-Cola writes about green colour and red seas, he didn't seem to have a clue what colour anything was. And that's how some people are with animals, isn't it? They are animal-minded. They often believe animals are mean and aggressive when the animals are simply frightened, warning you to stay away. Street dogs don't carry a stick or throw rocks at you and blind you. They just warn you as best they can. And animals try to bravely guard their young or their territory from invasion and harm. Species-blind people also think that animals are stupid or dumb, but they're really extraordinarily clever, and their languages are not only deep and diverse, but they have to try to understand our languages too. I love the study that showed that dogs who live with humans understand on average 200 human words, even if no one has taught them a single one. How many words of dog do humans understand? None. An astrophysicist, Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson, was quite skeptical that a dog named Chaser was reported to understand 1,000 human words, all for different objects. So last year, he put her to the test. He placed all the objects, they are all her toys, in a room, and he then asked her to fetch a particular object, and she ran next door, rummaged around, and came back with it. He gave her a couple of these tests, and then he said these words, "Fetch dog." Now, Chaser had not seen or heard of a toy named Darwin, because Dr. Tyson had never shown it to her. But what he did was he put it in the pile of 1,000 objects. Chaser went into the toy room and then she came back with nothing. She cocked her head at him. "Fetch Darwin," said Dr. Tyson. And off Chaser went again. And yes, this time she came back with the only toy she did know by name. It makes you wonder how many words she would know if her guardians hadn't stopped at 1,000. And as for altruism, the golden rule of do unto others as you would have them do unto you, bats will bring food to ailing bats and even help new mothers in childbirth. Pigeons who mate for life will risk their own lives to stay with a companion or a mate who has been shot or hurt. The ethologist Conrad Lorenz showed that geese sink into a depression if their hearts are broken. They shuffle instead of walking, they lose their appetites, and they no longer care about their appearance. In one notorious study, monkeys had to press a lever to get food. But if they could see another monkey in an adjoining cage who was given an electric shock when they pressed that lever, guess what? They refused that food. One monkey went hungry for 14 days rather than give an electric shock to his fellow. Human beings in studies, like the famous Milgram study, where they think they're given an electric shock, and they even hear the person screaming, will keep pressing the lever if just told to do so. Not for a food or any reward, just told. They'll press the lever even if they think the next shock may prove fatal. I shudder to think what is being done to these monkeys, little barren metal boxes in laboratories in India and around the whole world. These animals who outshine us in ethical conduct. As we say at PETA, it's not the animals who need their heads tested. As for being stupid, the examples to refute that convenient myth about animals are more than the number of raindrops in any monsoon. Like this one. And this. And this. I slept and dreamt that life was joy. I awoke and saw that life was service. I acted, and behold, service was joy. In other words, moaning is meaningless, and doing is everything. As Nike says, just do it. Because our journey through life is so brief, even though some people may not realize that. If we could only wear watches that reminded us not what the time is, but how much time remains in our lives, we would certainly hurry up and squeeze the most good deeds out of ourselves. We would never be silent. We would speak up all the time. We would educate, liberate, inspire others to act, to stop thoughtless cruelties, to be a living conscience. We would never fail to have animal rights magazines and pamphlets left like a trail of seeds wherever we go, from bus stops to airline seat backs. We would recommend vegan options to everything from footwear to food, from shampoos to soil. We would wear an animal rights button or t-shirt to show the way, not quietly creep, but openly encourage. We would be real advocates. There was a t-shirt about the Wild West, and every week the cowboy would rescue someone or do some other good deed. When the townspeople came out to thank him before he rode off into the sunset, he would say, "Oh, it was the least I could do." That always confused me. I say, we strive for the most we can do. Some days you may think, "Oh, I don't feel like pushing myself or saying something." But it's a little bit like going to the gym. Once you have, it's over, but you feel good. You did it. I know Oprah Winfrey visited India not so long ago. On her talk shows, she used to say to her audience, each of them had won a brand new car. I have great news for you today. No, don't look under your seat, there's nothing there. But the good news is that we have all won the lottery. I say that because in this world, most individuals have nothing but their skin, or their shell, or their legs, or their arms, or their wings. They have no house, no market, no roads, no tap for water, no hospital, no school, no refrigeration, no bus, no train, no holidays, no comfy mattress, no mobile phones. All they have is what they can get by on, from what nature gave them, and most of that has been taken away. They dig a home with their hands. They find plants to cure their illnesses, feed themselves with. They teach their young to survive. They get where they're going under their very own steam. We should be in awe. Dr. Jane Goodall once saw two well-paid, well-dressed congressional staff members laughing at a chimpanzee. The chimpanzee had been injured, and he was sitting at a table trying to eat with a knife and a fork. He wasn't doing so well. She said to them, "If I were to set you down in this chimpanzee's home, in the jungle, with none of your gadgets, no one to ask directions of, how long do you think you would last? Would you be able to build yourself a nest to sleep in, know what plants are poisonous and which nourish you, find clean water, navigate your way along, and so much more? No. You would likely die in this chimpanzee's world. Yet here he is, surviving in ours, on our terms. Respect him." When we grumble, it's good to remember that we have truly won life's lottery. That's what I mean. People say, "Oh, animals have no voice." But of course they have voices. It's just that most human beings don't pay attention to them, or even bother to understand them. Their cries just become background noise. On the other hand, we have a voice, but we often fail to use it, and our voices happened in Europe. We have won the lottery because our children are not taken away from us as dairy cows' children are, or locked in a cage as parrots' children are. We don't only watch the world go by, we can move about freely in it. We are comparatively rich. No, we're madly rich, all of us. So let's share our winnings, our material wealth, and our freedom of speech, and our freedom of action for those who truly need us but who didn't win that lottery. And as the beloved Jane Guru Chitravanaji and other wise people remind us, don't let material things cloud our souls. Caring about stuff rather than about living beings reduces our lives to a bowl of dal. If you don't already do this, I invite you to join me in tithing your income. Because even the poorest among us is far better off than the animals we love and worry about. Goethe's words might well have been written for this conference. He wrote, "I have come to the frightening conclusion that I am the decisive element. It is my personal approach that creates the climate. I possess tremendous power to make life miserable or joyous. I can be an instrument of inspiration or do nothing. I choose to do." And here's another familiar expression. Take only memories, leave only footprints. Well, how about if we take opportunities and we leave behind new vegans? Opportunities abound. But if opportunity doesn't knock, let's abandon our timidity and build a door to let it through. Here is what Lady PETA staffer wrote about taking opportunities. She said, "Tessa and I were waiting in line at the supermarket when we noticed a dead chicken wrapped in plastic along with ingredients for dinner, all on the counter behind us. I commented how sad it was to see this chicken lying there dead. Tessa said, 'Look, he was a baby, that's why he's so small.' I asked Tessa if she thought that the chicken appreciated that he was antibiotic-free, because that's what the label said. And now here he was covered in plastic and about to be someone's dinner. I wonder if that had made a difference to him." Just at that moment, Layla said, a young fellow snatched up the chicken and exclaimed, "No! Baby chicken. I didn't even notice it was young. No, no." Tessa and I, Layla said, stared at each other in amazement. We had had no idea he was nearby and had overheard us. Layla said she jumped out of line to show him vegan foods, and he left with them and a glass walls DVD that Tessa had in her purse. Now that's vegan power. Before I go, please let me mention cows. Cows are amongst the gentlest of breathing creatures. None show more passionate tenderness to their young. One cow I came to know was called Susie. She was about to be loaded on a Virginia freighter bound for Venezuela when she turned around, ran back down the gangplank, and leapt into the river. Even though she was pregnant, or perhaps because she was pregnant, she managed to swim all the way across the river, getting onto an island and eluding capture for several days. She was rescued by PETA, and she was sent to a home where she gave birth to Jimmy, her calf, and they remained together, devoted to each other, mother and son, for many, many years. The milk she made was for Jimmy, not for any human being. And so it is with every mother cow. The milk she makes is not for us, but for her own children. She never recovers from her children being taken away from her. No mother ever does. Her cries for her child taken away is in every drop of milk, every cube of cheese, and every bit of curd. Let me read you a poem by Maureen Duffy, entitled Shackle. Driving back Asia Festival through Otley, handsome black stone with white ravine.